That'd be right along the lines of cities.
Okay, it's 7 o'clock, you ready? We'll call this meeting of the Elsters Plan Commission to order. Judy, can you take the roll, please?
Indeed. Reed.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
Pozel.
Here.
Mayor Stiles.
Here.
Yes, you are there. We are awaiting Adam Abraham. If he does not arrive within about 10 minutes, Christopher will be sitting in for him as the alternate.
Okay, thanks.
Also present is our solicitor from Coolidge Wall, Jessica Brockman, and the planner, Lee Swinner.
Thanks. Okay, we have an agenda in front of us. Anyone have any questions or any changes or modifications, additions? If not, we'll go to review of minutes. We have minutes from our meeting in November. Hopefully you had a chance to review them. I read them fairly carefully and did not find anything to change. Does anyone else have any changes on
minutes? Page 3 and 4, if we just take out that word development for comprehensive development plan and put in land use.
Gotcha.
And where is that? Oh, I see.
Bottom page 3.
Yeah, and on the back under agenda planning. Yeah, just strike development and put land use. Thank you.
Okay, do we have a motion to approve these minutes?
So move.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Abstain.
Okay. Opposed abstains.
And I'm sorry, who was the second on that?
Jerry. Do we have any communications other than, I don't think we do. Next item is council report.
Council meeting was basically took up the incidents of the last couple of weeks or so. Nothing else really.
You know, there was something, and you'll take me for reminding you of it, but the glass farm parking lot issue, and there was, in fact, a little discussion about whether or not that should kick back to the planning commission. Just
right.
Within, it was
right.
Thrown this way.
And what was the decision?
The council decision was to proceed with the parking lot.
We're proceeding with the parking lot, but the rest of the area is kind of thrown back to plan. I don't think we gave any direction.
Well, there are two things at work. One is that Tecumseh Land Trust and the village work together on a grant for the conservation area. That's one thing, and the grant was received. That's where the parking lot piece comes in. It was the remainder of the glass farm and what is to be done. Is there an overall plan? That was tossed about. That's fairly preliminary, but I think there was some interest in having the planning commission perhaps look at that, weigh in on that. Nothing
so
specific.
Should that be a future agenda item?
That might maybe be a good one to have, just have Jerry touch base back with council to see.
We'll see exactly what they want us to do.
Yeah, but are they talking in a larger context of the whole?
I think so, but then again, I'm not sure.
We approved the solar array on the one end.
Yeah,
the conservation area is the other end.
The other
so.
End. And then it's the middle.
The middle.
Yeah, there's no plan. What's is happening is chunks are getting used for this and that.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
There's no real
idea
or plan. The people in the community haven't been brought into it. I mean, it's just kind of been piecemeal. So.
And if I'm correct, it was Economic Sustainability Group has been kind of looking at both. Patty did an assessment. myself did give council a package of all the properties that we own. Properties in one end. But other than that, I really feel that the New Year's Eve issue and the police issue, most of our meetings are going to be centering around those. And I'll put the camera in. Kind of see what her thinking might be. And she was the one, if I'm correct, she was the one that kind of said it. It should go back to planning, but not real specific.
Yeah. Okay.
And just at some point, because I think everyone, including myself, forgot this, and maybe it goes on future agenda item, but you need to nominate the chair and the desk, because it's 2017, so it can go on future agenda, that's fine. I just don't want to get lost.
Oh, I can't believe why I forgot that.
Mr. Incoming.
Okay, thanks for that. Next on our agenda is public hearings. So the way these public hearings work is we hear from the village planner, we have discussion up here, we hear from the applicant, then we open the floor for comments, and then it comes back to planning commission then for any further discussion, and then some kind of a vote or approval or whatever. So that's kind of how the whole thing works. You know, we didn't have citizens' comments here on our agenda. Did it get dropped for some reason?
Just pure error. So fill that right in.
Typically, at this time of the meeting, we have citizens' comments. So if you're here to comment on something that's not on the agenda, you feel free to come up and say your piece. Okay, well, then we'll go back to the public hearings. So the first public hearing is a conditional use application from Eric Johnson regarding an accessory dwelling. Denise, do you want to start this off?
Sure, sure. Mr. Johnson has submitted an application for a conditional use to build a garage with an attached a carport and an accessory dwelling unit on the second floor. The Green Generation, Alex Melamed, actually brought the application to me, and exhibit three is.
That's not.
It's not a garage. There's no garage.
It's not a garage on the.
Well,
what?
If there's a carport.
There's a carport.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So is it going to be on? It's not the second floor. It's going to be on the ground floor.
First floor. Well,
oh, why did I? I'm
first
sorry.
Floor.
So it's one story.
Oh, it's one story.
Yeah. Carport and accessory dwelling.
Oh, okay. Sorry about that. Thanks for correcting me on that.
Sorry,
second
floor.
Yeah. Okay.
I thought maybe
I didn't. You know, I guess I made that assumption because I didn't have like a side view of the dwelling.
Yeah, we're just
yeah. Sorry.
Stages of design there.
Yeah. So anyway, Alex Melamed, the architect, is here tonight, and he submitted the site plan, which is Exhibit 3 in your packet. If you'll notice. In doing all of the dimensional requirements, everything as far as I can tell regarding lot size, dimensions, setbacks in the side yard, as well as the rear yard are good. Carports typically, if they have a roof on them, are considered as an accessory structure, and there would need to be a 10-foot setback on this, but the fact that there is a public alley, however, it is, as you can tell, has been abandoned as far as being used by the public. So there is a section in the code that allows a zero lot line for an accessory structure if there is an alley. It normally says an alley that is commonly used, which this is not, but it's not an abandoned alley. So.
Is it safe commonly used?
It says that in the code.
Uh-huh.
actually says owners of, let's see.
So, how is the accessory dwelling unit going to be accessed?
Yeah, it says, yeah. Yeah, I'll get to that. An accessory building or structure designed for and containing a vehicle entrance to be accessed from an existing publicly dedicated and commonly used alley may be located on the rear lot line if parking space plans have been approved. That was an administrator. So it is a publicly dedicated alley, and but it's not commonly used because it's not been maintained. So I did check, I went back and I talked to the street superintendent, who said there's some historical reference to that, but you know, nothing in writing. He said you're probably not going to find anything, you know, where there was just an agreement that it wasn't going to be used as an alley. And I went back into the 1940s looking to see if we had anything. I then went to Greene County Recorder's office, and with their staff, we went and looked at not only Mr. Johnson's lot, but the four or five lots that are owned by the church, and there wasn't any vacations of any alley. There wasn't any documents of any type of agreement between the village and the church as to the use of that alley. So, that being said, it's not to say it couldn't be an alley again. However, the street superintendent doesn't really want to maintain it or build it right now, and is concerned about the limestone entrance because of there's a lot of not a lot of visibility there with trees and bushes. And I had some concern about an accessory structure that seems to be encroaching in that alley on the limestone side. So overall, the suggestion is that if Mr. Johnson would be willing to put in his road, he would need to talk to our street superintendent for what the requirements of that might be. I'm sure he could do gravel. But if he would be willing to maintain it, he could then enter either from West Davis, which has been paved and maintained very nicely by the church, or enter from Stafford Street, going through their parking lot and turning right into his property. The church has bought that lot and made it into a parking lot, so they are using the parking lot with an exit only on the alley, so that people pull in and park in the parking lot, they exit going out onto Davis Street. And if you notice on one of the photographs.
Exhibit 5?
I'm sorry? Exhibit 5, is that?
Maybe.
They have an exit only sign.
Oh.
Is it 10? Is it exhibit 10? They have an exit only sign. But that's their sign. That's not.
It's not a village sign.
Right, that's not a village sign.
Okay. So your recommendations?
Not to let him have his accessory dwelling if he installs the property owner installs the road and maintains the road and accesses it from Davis Street or that parking lot off the Stafford.
Okay. So yeah, the structure itself meets all the requirements, right? In terms
yes.
of lot coverage and setback.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay.
It did.
Okay. So really, this is the only question.
Right. And I didn't know. Alex had mentioned it, but Eric clarified tonight that they had looked at vacating that alley at one point. But what was well happened?
Any questions for Denise?
How common is this of somebody wanting to redo an alley that sort of has been abandoned but not officially abandoned? Has that happened before?
No, I haven't been there that long.
Because yeah.
so,
I know we have the people who want to vacate alleys.
Right.
But this was really quite different.
But we're not, we're really not wanting to vacate any right now.
Yeah.
The council let us go ahead and do that on those two unusual ones, but they want to wait and look and see what we have as far as if there's something that they want to do with any that really connect.
If we approve this plan, it's going to take up a portion of the alley.
No, he's actually bringing the alley back to its, restoring it.
There'll be no structure.
If you look at this, the alley's right here. Here's the accessory dwelling.
Is it a three, that big one?
So I have a couple questions. Have we heard from the church at all?
No.
So we can't technically say you have access through the church's driveway or
parking lot.
We can only say through the alley off of Davis or Limestone.
Correct. And that's why I suggested as one of the things is that they talk to the church really to just see what they would prefer.
Should we tell the church to take down the exit only sign? Because can they put up an exit only sign on a public alley?
Well, not in reality, but the fact is that they're the ones who probably cut down all the shrubs and everything.
But it's a public alley. I mean,
and then they paved it for their own use.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean it's theirs.
Yeah.
Right.
Not necessarily. Right.
Yeah, it looks like is there. I guess, I don't see a very specific drawing or photograph. Like, in Exhibit 5, that where the alley sort of extends and then the paved part ends, is that directly aligned with the alley? Or is it offset a little bit onto the, that would be the west?
No, I don't have that.
The alley.
Is it?
Rose, I think that asphalt is the alley.
Okay.
Right there you see his fence.
Okay.
Which is on another
so,
one of the drawings.
So technically, they would really only have to pave, a short part of the alley to be able to access that back corner of their property. They wouldn't necessarily have to gravel and take out all those trees all the way out to West Limestone unless they needed access to West Limestone.
Right. Well, then that structure's in the way too.
Yeah.
How was that structured with the idea?
No.
Is it really in the way?
Mm-hmm. It's on
the one picture. Part of it is on.
I mean, I'm sure it's not exact, but it's. I mean, when I did a little measuring thing, I think it's a 15-foot alley, and it's about 9 feet over there by where it encroaches quite a few feet.
It seemed over to the center line of the alley?
Not quite.
Not
just cuts off about a quarter of it or
yeah.
Anything.
Yeah, kind of the small fast and loose days about 100 years ago, they were putting garages.
Yeah, you don't have any idea how old that building is?
It
looks pretty old by now.
Yeah, about one of those.
See, people are playing fast and loose because it was dead, too. We haven't changed that much. Okay, any more questions for Denise?
Yes. So, really, the only way this structure can be approved, because since it's on almost on the property line, is if the alley is used.
Well,
if it's paved.
Alex mentioned an alternative, Alex, the architect, off of High Street, but when I looked at there, if you look at Exhibit 11, which is the only location, I thought, well, maybe if you could come there, you'll see there's that little white pipe that's coming out of the ground there, so I don't even know what utility easements might be in that area. I'm not aware. So unless Alex might be able to shed any light on that.
Step up?
No.
I think the notion of a high street access would be to use their existing driveway and just walk around to the back. So, and omit the carport in the new design. That's not what we're looking for, though.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you identify yourself for the folks
I'm
on
Alex
television?
Bellman, Green Generation Building Company. I am a non-licensed architect.
Sorry.
And I have to say that.
Any more questions for Denise? If not, do you want, or do you want Alex to?
I guess I have one more question, I'm sorry. Can we, is there enough parking on the property as is to approve the accessory dwelling with the carport on it and just let them figure out access later? Like, do we have to establish that they have access to the carport that they're building if they have parking, adequate parking on the property now without access to the new carport?
I didn't really look at that. I mean, every single family dwelling has to have two spaces, and then the accessory dwelling has to have an additional space.
So it looks like their parking lot is pretty near their...
Two-car garage.
Yeah, they have a two-car garage. They have a large driveway. Can we actually deny this based on not having access to a carport that could definitely have access in the future by an alley that really just some honeysuckle needs to be taken down and some gravel needs to put there?
I think if we think it's okay for them to use the alley, then we need to tell them that. We can't just not.
Of course
tell
it's okay for them to use the alley.
And then, so, yeah, but so then how does he use it and what conditions and all that stuff? And we need to just figure that out so they know, we know, so it's none of this building a structure in an alley like this happened 100 years ago. Not that they're planning to do that, but just so that everybody's all in agreement what how to move forward.
I mean, if you're saying it's okay for them to use the alley, then in my mind, I would think that it would be for their best use to have an ability to park off of the accessory dwelling. And they definitely have more than enough lot space for everything, including the dimensions of the carport with what they could have as far as coverage, lot coverage.
But I think back to Rose's point, it's an alley that's an alley. It's obviously there for access.
Yeah.
Right? So there shouldn't be a question about whether they can use it. It's how do we get to that point?
Can I add something?
Sure.
If you look at exhibit, the satellite view, which I'm going to use.
Okay.
Two,
which
would be exhibit
one
or two?
One should work.
This one?
Two will also work, yeah. You can see there's if you're making the alleyways contiguous between the block north.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, it seems appropriate for that to be a continuous thing. I understand the village's desire not to have to maintain more than they are now, given the burden that the streets are. Yeah, they don't do. Homeowners do most of their plowing and such. Is that right?
If it's a dedicated alley like what you have on Phillips and what you have behind on Limestone Continuing, the village they'll snowplow that and they'll go through that as long. But people have to maintain everything to keep things out of the way of the alley.
Right.
So if they have hanging tree limbs or
cars.
Yeah, they have to maintain all of that, right?
Yeah. But it might make it easier for the village to do that plowing if it is contiguous.
Well, they don't do it for the church now, is what I'm saying. He's not maintaining that. And they don't have any plan to.
Have you talked to the church about this?
Working
on it.
I know. Technically, he would not have to talk to the church.
True.
You know, because it's a nullity.
Right.
Now,
they just have to pay to.
The church just happened to do it. We find no record of them approaching anybody. It was just done. Mm-hmm. Okay. So now we have a case where an individual is following the proper procedures and so forth. And if we approve it, then it's up to either us or Denise to notify the church that it is now an ally, and it will fall under it.
Well, but it's going to be extended and someone else is going to use it.
Right, someone else is going to use it.
Period.
Period. Yeah.
Yeah.
And,
can I say?
Yeah.
Eric Johnson. In defense of the church, their parking is at an angle. So if you come in their exit, you know, it would be very difficult to park there. So I think it makes sense for their purposes that that'd be an exit for their purposes. Now their members can, I guess, come in that way and leave that way. And I don't know if anyone else is going through there. But, and I do recall, I did call them and leave a message and said we were going to do an accessory dwelling. And this was before the sign went up, it was quite a while ago.
Well, I mean, is it, how many days a week are the people parking in that gravel lot?
For us?
For the church.
One day.
Just on Sundays?
And funerals.
Yep.
Yeah,
yeah, okay, funerals. Right, okay.
It's very, very peaceful. It's very, you know, comfortable.
Yeah.
Everybody, does, you know.
But I'm saying, if you have one car there, it's not going to create some weird havoc that's going to be a problem for you or them.
I wouldn't think so.
Yeah. Yeah, I wouldn't think so either.
Yeah, and to me, they would now have to live with the fact that there could be two-way traffic going through the other.
Yeah, but
yeah.
Not like a street, though.
Not,
it's going
not
to be
a street. Yeah. No.
Yeah. Of course.
I have a question. Your intent is just to extend the alleyway to access the carport.
Well, that's Denise's suggestion, so that's fine with us.
Okay. Would you consider like mowing so that you can have a walkway through there so that the individual...
I've done that before, and I'm sure I'd be happy to do that. You know, it's up to you whether you want the alley to go all the way through or not.
To lines.
I think it's... the reason that it's overgrown so much, exiting onto limestone would be hazardous. The traffic on limestone is so fast there that sticking another vehicle's nose out may be precarious. I would think a walkway would be delightful, but I think just accessing the dwelling is all you need in the alleyway.
Or we could put a one-way sign.
I really confound things. I'm trapped.
The alley on the other side of limestone, this the one that's behind Stafford and High, they come right out onto limestone, and there hasn't been one here
well,
that problem.
No obstruction.
Well, I know, but the obstruction, honestly, I don't think it's on that, but it's ours. The obstruction is our problem. You know, it's overgrown.
No, we're talking about the little
building
there.
But the building, if you look at it, it's set back from limestone quite a bit.
Yeah, but it encroaches into the alley itself.
Oh, you're right on that.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then you also have to have a 20-foot clear line of vision when you're back entering the street, and you have that on the across. I mean, it would mean that you would have to tear it out or cut back a lot
sure.
of the...
Okay, thanks. So Denise made some recommendations. I guess I need to open public hearing.
Yes.
Okay, so this is a public hearing for anyone who has any comments on the conditional use request from Eric Johnson for 401 South High Street. If we'll open the public hearing, if you have anything to say, please go up and say it. Okay, it looks like no one is going to say anything, so I'm going to close the public hearing, and now it comes back to us. Any more discussion? I have one point. Denise made some recommendations, and your request number or comment number two, recommendation about the village requirements. In fact, I don't think we should put any requirements on them. They're just, if nothing, they're improving what's there. I mean, I understand why we want to maybe notify, you know, the street department. But
it is a right of way though, so you're gonna have to get him working in the right of way permit.
Well, that's fine.
Yeah.
But we don't want to give him a specification for building a gravel road and having him expect him to meet it when really he's trying to build a 15-foot long driveway.
Yeah.
In my mind, I mean, and if it doesn't work for the people living there, then they'll improve it to the point where it does work for them. So, I mean, I don't know that we need to tell them how to build it.
Are you on the conditions of approval?
I'm looking at Denise's recommendations.
Okay, number two, got it.
Yeah.
And so you're saying you don't think that the alley, that there should be a requirement to do anything to it?
No, I mean, I think we need to get the permit for working in the right way, and mm-hmm. needs to talk to Jason, but I don't think we're in a position to dictate how this should be built. Unless somebody has some other ideas about that.
I agree with you there. And while you're at it, number four, the alley would be maintained by the property owner.
That's a large statement.
I
was thinking, like, what if the neighbors across the alley, they put a little accessory dwelling unit on their corner, and they were using that little driveway area of the alley, and these folks were required to maintain it.
Right.
I mean,
Can you specify per codified ordinances 1020.04 where you have to maintain to the center of the alleyway? That's just the village.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can see that. So I can see them having to maintain it to the center of that, which is what.
So then you're putting the burden then on the village to have to maintain the other part.
Yes.
It's
the other property owner on the other.
That's the other side. Yeah, the other 10 feet.
Well, is that how the dedicated alleys in town? Is that how they work? Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, by not saying, I mean that sort of, we don't have to say anything because that's how it works.
And
a 15-foot alley, half of that is 7.5 feet. It's almost, you know, to be able to get your car through.
That's all you need.
That's all you need, technically. So, okay.
Now number five.
Number five is not a requirement in terms of, it's not asking permission, is what I want to say. It's more just good neighbors, letting you know I've gotten approval to do this. You know, I can come straight from Data Street, but.
So it's a suggestion.
Yeah,
a
suggestion.
Here's someone comes to visit, okay, and they come in off of Davis Street, okay? And the church can't object to that.
Right.
Okay. Or, because a carport to me says it's going to be for a car, so he leaves his and goes out
Davis and they come back, they come in Davis. Because the church could say that they don't want them driving through their parking lot.
Yeah, they could say that, yeah.
And
or they could say, please don't come in off Davis, you can use our parking lot. That's why communication is.
Or, yeah, and the we allow something to happen that shouldn't happen to begin with, and letting them pay and assume that they had control of that area, and you know.
We shouldn't have let them pay.
No, we shouldn't.
Well, or they could have paid them for their use. With the knowledge that it's not theirs.
Right.
Yeah.
And they may have done that anyway.
It's possible they know that.
Yeah, correct.
Yeah.
But they, well, they wouldn't have put up the interest in that.
Maybe they would have put up that.
No, see, because they took down the other one. There were two signs. There was one where the parking lot is, and there was one at Davis Street. They took down the sign from the parking lot because they knew that.
Yeah.
And they should have taken out the same sign as the Davis. Because I asked them, because I was cleaning the ground, and I said, why is the sign now? They should have put the sign back. And they said, no.
Yeah.
We can't do that.
Because they would have nowhere to exit?
Oh, no, they can exit.
Yeah.
It is that all they had to do is change their mind. Yeah, one way. They just had it died because they thought they could.
Yeah. See, I mean, they can go out that way.
They can go in and out the parking lot and not have to use it.
But they can also go in and out the alley because it's public.
Right.
So that's why to me, these folks, and, you know, other than being a good neighbor, telling them what they're doing, but they don't have to come to me.
No.
Yep.
And that's not what I was saying
okay.
in that.
Yeah, that's what I want. That's what
I'm sure you guys will.
We've been really very good neighbors, the church and us, so I don't think there's any problem with this, having the conversation.
The church was notified, about this.
Well.
Sent a letter.
Yeah. I sent it to the tax property address.
Okay.
That's what I'm supposed to do.
Know.
So.
Well, that's a sign.
Your site's up for your house.
Right.
Yeah.
You also have to mail them.
I have a question that, you know, probably it's really none of our business, but I wonder, what are you planning on using your new structure for?
Either an Airbnb or an apartment.
Okay, that's what I wondered, if you're thinking of Airbnb.
They going to have a microwave?
They have to follow everything in the accessory dwelling.
So,
yeah.
So yes,
official, yeah.
They have to follow all that. I just think it's ridiculous we require.
Oh yeah, it probably won't have a microwave.
Yeah.
I did notice when I walked around the property on Sunday that the end of the driveway where it ends next to your property is used as a parking spot for the congregation. So I'm assuming that they may just be disappointed that they're going to lose a parking spot.
Now, you're talking about
where the alley is going through, where the alley
is now, and it dead ends into the where the overgrown area is. There's a car that was parked there.
Yeah, but normally it's for just loading and unloading in the kitchen.
Mm-hmm. But you know, it's one space going on a Sunday.
I don't think so either.
Yeah.
Okay, well, with all that being said, do we have a recommendation regarding this conditional use application?
Okay, now.
Sounds like we're in agreement that we just need to maybe.
Let's go through the conditions.
Get some language and all the Jesus recommendations.
I would say on number one, on the conditions that the abandoned alley will not be accessed via Limestone Street by vehicle, but perhaps by pedestrian.
But this is only in reference to this property owner.
That's correct.
Can we say that? Can we tell someone to not use an alley in a vehicle?
Well, then I think you brought up against the phrase abandoned alley. If the alley is improved at some point, then no, you cannot. But you may in fact be able to say that if the alley is considered abandoned.
While abandoned?
So it's not an abandoned alley.
Well, section of it still
will be. A section of it will be.
Maybe Jessica.
But it's not officially abandoned.
Maybe just, no, Jessica will clarify that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's abandoned because we're not taking care of it.
Yeah, there's a difference between abandoned and vacated.
Okay.
Yeah.
The abandoned section of the alley?
I would just stay with number one as is.
By vehicle.
Yeah. No, just keep it the way Denise suggested.
All right, that's easier. And I think, I suggest that we take number two and just say that, instead of village requirements, just say to notify the village of the timing of the approval.
The improvements of what?
Just when he's going to do the driveway, so that Jason's curious, he can go out there.
Okay. But he doesn't have to do a driveway, is what we're saying, really.
Right, we're saying that he can do what he's proposed to whatever extent he thinks he needs to so that he can access the carport. And whether that's paved or
so leaving the first line,
leaving
the first line, the as road will be installed by the property owner and then notify village of the timing of the alley.
I said improvements.
The property owner shall contact.
The timing of the improvement. Okay, of the improvements. All right.
Number three, I mean, he needs to do that.
Okay.
Yeah, because I also don't know. I noticed there was like an electric pole at the one end, and I just don't know where all that stuff is buried, and
yeah, we'll get hoops out there and try to.
Yeah.
Is there a power line to there?
It'd be above ground.
Is there a power line right along the alley?
There's a pole.
There's a pole.
It's close to the pole.
Yeah.
And it's above ground to our house.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Probably not
been
above ground to
that. On number four, I'd strike it.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. And really, it's number five, we could probably strike that too.
So, change number six to number four?
Yeah. Well, that's probably the last time that they cleared the alley. That's when they had to get in there to do something really left.
Whatever. It's just honeysuckle there, no big oaks or anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, honeysuckle's everywhere, you know.
Yeah, it should be clear now.
Okay, so we have essentially now, what, four conditions?
Yes. I move to approve the accessory dwelling with the conditions stated, the 4 points.
Do you have those conditions, Judy?
I do indeed. Do you want them back?
Sure. Just to make sure we have.
Okay, they are. Number one, the abandoned alley will not be accessed by a limestone street. Number two, the alley's road will be installed by the property owner, and the property owner will contact Jason Hanby, the village superintendent of streets, to notify the village of Bell Springs as to the timing of the alley improvements.
Number three, the property owner shall contact the village's zoning office for a permit to work in the right-of-way. And number four, allow the carport to be located, the village will allow the carport to be located next to the rear property line as it is a dedicated alley, even though the section of the alley is abandoned and therefore not commonly used.
Okay, we have a second. Okay, thank you. We have a second. Call.
Who's your second?
Jerry. Dr. Call the roll.
Indeed. Sims?
Yes.
Stiles?
Yes.
Cervuken?
Yes.
Hozel?
Yes.
Reed?
Yes. Thank you very much. Good luck.
I just want to say thank you very much, because I feel like I think you said it, or maybe you said it, but you said these people are here in goodwill. You know, it's like we want to improve things. So I just appreciated the disposition that you were positive about the request.
I also want to thank all the federal
Yeah.
I guess that's maybe part of the course, but I'm
impressed. Thanks,
guys.
Well, and Chris walking over the property, that's pretty impressive, too. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Thanks. Good luck.
Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Okay. Next item on the agenda is a text amendment revision to Chapter 1248 regarding the spatial requirements. And Denise, do you want to remind us of what
Right.
We did?
This, you're probably might have gotten a little bit confused because you're going to see spatial requirements also being amended for if we go forward with Pocket Neighborhood. But this spatial requirement had to do with the meeting the BZA had regarding the dwellings on Dayton Street and the fact that. There was general consensus amongst BZA and Planning Commission at the previous meeting that when council took out minimum requirements for the size of dwellings, that just by virtue of the number of units per acre and the lot coverage and the setbacks, all are set in place as the driving force to make those properties meet the requirements, and to add this additional language of 4,500 square feet per unit and 4,000 in high density, it's confusing for what you can do and can't do, and it pretty much conflicts with what you're allowed to put on. You'd never be able to put that amount on an acre if you had some of these requirements. So the thought was to strike out the 4,500 square feet per unit in RB and the 4,000 square feet per unit in RC and just let all of the other requirements dictate the use of that
right.
part.
So does everybody recall this whole
yes.
conversation?
Yes.
Any questions for Denise about this? Okay. If not, then I will open the public hearing for comments from the public on this revision of Chapter 1248. Since I think there will be no comments, I'll close the public hearing. Any further discussion here? And if not, do I have a motion to adopt these changes?
I move that we adopt the changes.
I second.
Any further discussion? I have one comment, Denise, unfortunately. I think it was a typo. In footnote number two.
A density up to 8 units per acre.
Up to permitted.
Two-family, attached single-family, and multi-family dwellings are permitted a density up to 8 units per acre.
Permitted a density?
Well, a density was what is how it is in everything else, so I don't know.
Okay.
Is that
because yeah, it's in three also?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just going with what was already in the code.
Okay.
So, I know.
That is a strange...
Yeah, I read it several times. Okay.
Well, one thing about this that will be really helpful if that's out of there is then, you know, what happened before was all of a sudden I was taking things like, oh, well, if it's 4,000 square feet and you can only have 3.5 of something when, you know, they could clearly put four, it's just, yeah.
Okay. All right, sorry for the little sidebar there.
That's okay.
June, you want to take the roll, please?
Yes. Styles.
Yes.
Hozell.
Yes.
Jabuthin.
Yes.
Sims.
Yes.
Reed.
Yes. Okay.
I have a question just for my own purposes. Is it just the table that is being changed on that? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
Just the third. Right now on that.
Okay, the next public hearing is for the text amendment to chapter 1262.8, the definition of these special requirements, or specific requirements for short-term rentals.
Okay, at the last meeting we clarified the dwelling unit being a dwelling unit or a room in a dwelling unit. And we added the word daily, so to cover every aspect of a possible Airbnb under the short-term rentals. One of the things, though, that was requested was that we staff look at some other requirements. So I added more information in there off of, pretty much taken from the accessory dwelling unit. Not completely, but... So I wanted to discuss that a little bit. Under location, a short-term rental unit may be located in a principal single-family detached dwelling. In other words, it could be a house, a whole house, or it could be a room within the house, or it could be in a detached accessory dwelling on the same lot as a principal dwelling. But I guess is when I started thinking, well, then do we want to say that no more than one short-term rental unit per lot is allowed? I mean, because are we going to get into a situation where you're going to have the house is going to be rented out and the accessory dwelling is going to be rented out and then it's going to...
You could have that situation.
Yeah, you could.
So,
I don't know. So we're just talking about the short-term rental. So that they could actually have, like if they have, like people
yeah.
over here, if they wanted to rent out the house, have a lease on it, a regular one, and then have the Airbnb in the new mm-hmm. one, that would be okay.
Well, why? Because one is a short-term rental unit and one is
long-term.
Would not be.
Long-term.
So even if it was a monthly lease?
Well, then that, our definition is short-term, I think our definition
if it was,
short-term was...
So if it's more than...
Monthly.
If it's more than monthly, see, this says, but typically less than 1 year. So if it's three monthly or tri-monthly or bi-monthly, is that still a short-term rental? Or is that a rental?
Well, that's a good question because,
read that again, definition.
A dwelling unit or room in a dwelling unit that is rented or leased to one person, family, or entity on a daily, weekly, or monthly basis, but typically less than 1 year.
So,
why does it say typically less than 1 year? I don't know. Can we strike that? And that would distinguish them?
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
Yeah.
And they strike them, but typically less than a year.
Well, we don't have a definition of rental property.
Hmm?
We have no definition for rental property.
No,
either,
we've never, we don't have any codes for rent. I mean, people can rent out their entire home, or we don't, the village doesn't oversee any of that.
So why are we overseeing this?
The short term?
Because of the short term.
Because of, it being short term.
So, but if it's, but typically less than 1 year, then it's could be long. I don't know what short term means. If it's just less than a year, is that what short term means?
But to me, if we take that out, then
I didn't go back and look at what the discussion was when they were writing the code to know what they were thinking. All I know is that the intent was to differentiate between a long-term rental of a house and
a short-term rental.
Yeah.
And we were trying to change this so that it would fit for Airbnbs.
By saying daily,
which are many times daily.
Yeah. So to me, if we take out the typically less than a year.
See, I think it should be monthly and less than 1 year should be taken out. Personally.
So you just think daily and weekly?
Daily and weekly. Because a month-to-month renter, right, in a room in a house...
It's not really an Airbnb.
Is not really an Airbnb.
But it could be a short-term rental. Because we're really fitting Airbnb under short-term rental by changing it to the daily.
Yeah.
Or adding the daily.
But we're adding all of these requirements like... only one per, you know, like if that example was one, you know, the accessory dwelling unit was on a month to month and the house was on a month to month, they would only be allowed one rental unit on a lot.
Right.
Googling this quickly.
Yeah.
It says, when it comes to short-term rental zoning, communities have to decide on a policy that fits their history and ideals. Often the short-term rental zoning provisions define short-term as less than 30 days. The same concept may be called transient rentals or short-term transient rentals.
Yeah.
And we were saying something about that
too. So maybe we need to say less than 30 days.
You could say that.
To say?
Because many times when you have a lease, you sign a lease initially for 1 year.
And then it goes to month to month.
Right. So to take what Rose is saying, that maybe we just say lease to one person, family, or entity for less than 30 days.
30 days,
yeah.
Okay.
Would that work for you?
Yeah.
For fewer than 30 days.
Yeah, that sounded wrong. I'll let you out of
this, but I wish. So, would you reread the definition then? Is that what you're changing?
So you're saying a short-term rental unit is a dwelling unit or room in a dwelling unit that is rented or leased to one person, family, or entity for fewer than 30 days?
And not renewed. Do we want to add that?
No.
So we'll have to, yeah.
No, because if it is renewed on a weekly basis, that would still be a short-term
rental. Not anticipating that we were going to change the already decided upon definition, I did not notice that. So I'm going to have to bring it all back anyway.
Okay.
I'm just going to have to.
We can't vote on it tonight.
Yeah, you can vote on it and prove it so that I'll just bring it back the next time for final standard approval. Yeah.
Okay,
so then that takes me back down to this idea of, you know, do we want to have a situation where a person rents their house out and their accessory dwelling units in a short-term way?
I could see that happening.
Somebody's
down in Florida for the winter. They're renting their house and they're renting their accessory dwelling. And then that could happen. Do we want it to happen?
Yeah, well, I think that's
what
you want to happen.
Do we want less than
30
days?
No, we're talking more than 1 unit
on a property.
Oh,
indeed.
So if you rent the house long term and the accessory dwelling short term,
that's allowed
right now.
So they would have to get, or maybe they wouldn't have to, would they have to notify us that they were doing that?
Yeah.
Okay, so then we could look at it, because further on, I think.
Right, that's conditional use, right?
Maybe that's.
Yes, it'll be a conditional.
And so then we could look at how many there are in the neighborhood, and if there weren't any others in the neighborhood, maybe that's okay.
And conditional use means that the neighbors get notified as well.
Yeah.
So, well, so we could say up to two.
Yes,
maybe, how about up to two units?
Well, Jessica said that limiting it in the neighborhood could be a problem for us.
Yeah, I mean,
enough of this, we don't want any more of these. That's different.
Yes, that's
we can't just arbitrarily say, oh, there's too many.
No, you can't. No.
Okay.
I mean, I think if you say only two,
yeah.
I mean, I think that's different. But you can't say in this neighborhood, because there's RV.
So
yeah.
Right now it says only one per lot. Do we want to say two per lot? I mean, I think this is such a...
Well,
this is so much more specific to Airbnbs now. I'm very happy about our change that I'm comfortable limiting it to one if that's what we...
Well, is there an issue there that you just changed that definition because it says if an accessory dwelling unit already exists, and I wouldn't assume that that is a short-term rental.
Right, right.
Additional short-term rentals
that
are allowed. That might need to be clarified.
I don't know, maybe two is a...
I don't know, if we can't limit it in a neighborhood, then...
We could at least limit it on the lot.
Yes, then that concerns me because you could have in a neighborhood, I mean, I don't know, you could have two on a number of lots and neighbors may feel like that's really not what they want. They thought it was a residential neighborhood and suddenly it's turned into something different.
Well, right now it's not regulated at all, and they could have, there could be as many, and we've been having complaints, right?
Mm. Yeah, but it's been very weird. They're sort of like anonymous complaints. They're not like people aren't willing to come forward, so they're just asking over the phone that they're not identified themselves as to what we have as far as restrictions. But I have had people that, I've had at least one or two people that have called and said that, one was from out of town, was thinking about buying a property and doing it at Airbnb. Well, that's fine, I guess, but if there's an accessory dwelling unit and there's a house, then that can just definitely turn into like a little hotel business right in the middle of your neighborhood.
Yeah.
I just.
But they would need conditional use approval.
They would, but what
you don't want
is saying, we could have trouble limiting the number in the neighborhood.
And that's why we limit per lot.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. Plus it gets you from having them go through all, I mean, that it kind of stops it before it even has to come
to
being
a problem.
Yeah.
I'm okay with it limited to one.
I am too.
And then we strike that last sentence for B.
Yeah.
Because in fact, you can always change just the little point.
Sure.
Right.
If everybody in town says, no, we want to
the lot,
So we're striking the last sentence in B.
So then for number C, we have an accessory dwelling unit saying two adults only in that accessory dwelling unit. So I just thought, well, that can't really be any different for the short-term rental because they were an accessory dwelling unit to begin with. So that's why I thought if it's located in the accessory dwelling, no more than two adults shall occupy.
Two adults, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So family for rentals.
Yeah.
But if it's a house.
That's different,
okay.
Yeah.
So that's just the accessory dwelling.
And the way I understand the accessory dwelling, it's only supposed to be adults. I mean, it's not supposed to be children.
What?
Accessory
dwelling units.
Is it?
I don't think you can do that.
Can you legally
do that?
I don't think you can. You can say two. I think you can say two persons.
Yeah, that's the Fair Housing Act. You're not allowed to.
Okay.
So the rest of this really is just the accessory dwelling.
Two individuals.
Yes.
Stuff.
But it's you can say no more than two adults, but you can't say no kids.
Yeah, no more than two adults. That
means
you can have your kids.
And then
ingress, egress, we had that, no new access points or driveway shall be created or installed for access to the short-term rental unit. That was one of the things that was a point in the accessory dwelling unit. I did bring that, we didn't talk about it tonight though on this other thing, but it doesn't, it's coming off the alley anyway.
Yeah, so it's not,
not a big deal, but.
So that ingress and egress was, is there for the same reason the utilities were there. There was concern that if you allow accessory dwellings, that you're essentially going to de facto subdivide.
Short-term rentals.
Well, just subdivide a lot.
Not accessory dwelling unit, short-term rentals.
Yep, right. But I mean, that's why these clauses are in the accessory dwelling requirements as well.
Yeah.
You got to share utilities. You can't have a new driveway. Yeah. So you can't de facto subdivide a property.
Yeah.
I have a question on the parking, because in the we're allowing a one room to be rented, and the parking is requiring then an additional parking space. That seems a bit much.
Well, a single family house has to have two parking spaces. So if you have an accessory dwelling unit, you have to have at least one additional parking space. So I guess the thought was, if you're going to subdivide out your house.
If you're just renting out one bedroom.
Yeah.
Then you should have another parking space.
Yeah. I don't know how to differentiate it otherwise.
Most houses have more than two parking spots.
Yeah, off street.
Your house is big enough.
I guess, I mean, is that something that can be modified for somebody in a planning commission hearing?
Yeah.
It's not a BZA thing, because BZA has to do with square footage. And
yeah, it would be, we would be able to put conditions.
So let's just leave it as is, and then if someone has,
I mean, they may have a little place downtown where there's absolutely no ability to have any parking.
Then we can grant that as a...
Sure.
Wait, can we do that?
We have a provision in there to even allow for the reduction of parking if you can show, like, bicycle racks, or...
Okay.
And if it's downtown, you can do, a 25% reduction.
Okay.
Okay, so leave the parking language as is?
Yes.
Is there anything else anybody can think of?
So you got the size corrected. Okay. Okay. I don't know that we need to have the public hearing. What do you want to go and advertise it again, though, do you?
No, I can't.
Do you have to?
Advertising is not a big deal because it's just putting it in the paper. Because it's a text amendment, I don't put a sign up or there's nobody to mail to. So it's not a big deal.
Well, regardless, if you want to do this now, we can do this now. It'll take 2 seconds.
We still have to come back on this other anyway, because you're modifying something I didn't put in the paper. See, that's what I'm saying. See, that's the thing I wasn't expecting.
Okay. So we might as well deal with it all at the same time.
Yeah.
Okay. Any more comments or questions on this? Okay. It's going to be on our old business next time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good job, everyone.
The last, well, not the last item, but the next item is our ongoing discussion regarding pocket neighborhood ordinance. So we've been back and forth on this, and
bless you.
Excuse me.
I guess, Denise, do you want to go through it?
Yeah. Jessica helped me with this and found language that where it is actually fits into a conditional use. And as I went through it and actually sat down with Mr. Donnell again and reviewed it with him, and it became a lot clearer to me, and I understand it a lot better and think that it could work very well as a conditional use and not being in the PUD and not going through that requirement. Mainly because if we stick with this as being single-family detached units,
all on one lot or acreage, and that lot doesn't get subdivided out. It's, basically, it would be a homeowners association set up, and then the people would own the house, but not the land underneath it. It makes this much easier to do as a conditional use. So going through this, I know we had talked about not having pocket neighborhood developments in RA, but RA does allow for up to 6 units per an acre. Mm-hmm. So why not? You know, we have some acreage, and it's not going to be. We're governing it with the RA requirement of 6, no more than 6. We'll put that there.
And in fact, you know, having looked at the comprehensive plan and the vision, one of the things that they talk about is having a higher density throughout the village.
Throughout the village, right. Yeah. And I think this is kind of a creative way to do that. I don't know how many we'll have.
But, yeah, we might not have.
But, you know, but it's there.
Right. A question about the Antioch College wanting to put housing on their land in the cottage or the neighborhood.
Right, I know what you're saying.
Fits. Under, so then does that become rezoned RA, B, or C? How is it? Because currently it's educational.
With what they were proposing at the time that we sat down with them, which was a while ago, and from since, they'd have to go through a PUD anyway because they were wanting, they were going to go through, they're not going to take an acre and only have, actually it's educational, it's not even, it's educational. So they would have to rezone as a.
Yeah. So they would have to go through a rezoning for residential.
Planned unit development. Or
it would be a planned unit.
Or rezone it, ask to be rezoned to resident B.
Okay.
Or
thanks. I had a. I'm reading.
Yeah,
this
and I mean,
like,
I think what over
the
there is
going to do that.
And what in that location is RB, isn't it?
Yeah. Well, it's RB along with
Xenia Avenue is RC on the facing Xenia Avenue all the way up is RC, but any houses right behind it, I think, are RB.
No, there's actually some.
Oh, are there some
RC?
RC? Oh, okay, so.
In that neighborhood.
Yes, RC until you get to the south end of the college.
So they would have the option of a rezone to RC or a PUD.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and then they do 14, they can do up to 14 units per acre, which I, again, I don't know with what they're planning to do.
Okay.
And again, this is only specific to single family detached. I know they were looking at co-housing, and that's a whole other thing.
Yeah.
So more than likely, they'd have to rezone the PUD.
But those ideas, I'm sure, are evolving for them as well. So.
Right.
Is, may I ask why, and if we discussed it, why wouldn't attached be permitted?
Yeah.
I think
there's specific
places where attached is not allowed, which I think is RA.
Right. And so that's,
yeah.
Two family dwellings are not permitted in RA.
Mm-hmm.
Nor are multiple family dwellings.
Yeah.
Not even as a conditional use.
So, I mean, they could come and apply for an RA. I mean, they could come and apply for an attached.
Oh, they could.
Yeah, but not an RA. They could come in and B,
yeah,
and C, and do multifamily or attached.
And it may not even have been in anything. The ones I have seen have generally been detached housing. But when we keep saying that, I'm thinking, well, why wouldn't you allow, like, you could have several, two, you know, because it would simply be cheaper for construction.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I guess there's kind of anything that you buy, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. Yep.
Attached. Okay.
And I think, you know, this is a
good start, and if it, if things happen with this, and if, you know, if people come with some of these other ideas, then we can decide if they have to do it as a PUD, or if they can come through this and we just want to pass them. I don't, you know.
I mean, I personally like it as a conditional use. I think it makes it easier. It's easier than an overlay. It's easier than, a lot easier than a PUD. I think it meets, like Susan was saying, it just, it pushes again towards that density as an option for people in the village. Has anyone talked to the rest of council about this? This is not a huge change, but it's fairly significant. They know we're talking about this, and that we might.
I don't know. I've not talked to
anyone.
Wasn't Judith at our last meeting?
Yes.
Yeah.
And then
council.
I know they're busy.
Yeah.
I mean, you update them on what we're doing.
Yeah, so. I'd be very surprised if council had an issue with this.
Yeah.
And Judith was at the last one when Ted was talking.
Right.
Yeah.
I have a question under the uses, number two. Buildings are under single ownership. So you're looking at these being individually owned.
Right.
Yes.
Not a...
But the land beneath it would be a homeowners association where all of you collectively control maintenance of the little parking lots and the green space areas.
Okay. And then on under the conditional use requirements,
where are we at? Are you skipping ahead on me? Or
what? I might be jumping ahead.
Yeah, because I was trying to go through this and we got stuck on 1284.03. So let me go ahead on 1248.03 spatial requirements. One of the things, even though we did a modification tonight regarding taking out the 4,500 square feet and 4,000 square feet, you'll notice on this I deleted it from it, because I figured this was going to pass. That we'll have to also, I forgot, we're going to need to add a number one footnote, or I might have to change the footnote. No, I'll keep it as number one. Under the RA, low density residential, and where it says one public water and sanitary sewer is required for all property in these districts, and a second sentence saying pocket neighborhood developments are permitted a density up to 6 units per acre, mm-hmm. which is, if you go back to the very front of residential,
yes.
RA is allowed up to 6 units per acre.
I think that's good. It adds a clarity.
Yeah. And then I was trying to figure out, you know, what is affected in the zoning code by this. And then, so the next one is the 1260.04 uses, principal uses per lot. We went ahead and put, just like PUDs are in there already, we put block and neighborhood developments. And then under conditional use requirements, this would now be at all of this underlying language would be added as under 1262.08E7 residential pocket neighborhood developments. I went ahead and put it as 7. It probably should be 6 because short-term rentals I think should now be made 7, but it was just too complicated for now to do that, so I'm just leaving it like this for now. We can fix that later.
Which one are you on?
1262.08, the next one after that.
You want to back up?
Yes, I'm sorry.
The only thing that I'm adding on that is what's underlined.
Okay.
That's already in the code.
Okay.
That's what I was trying to.
Yeah, this is what's underlined. Other than principal use per lot, that was already underlined.
I'm sorry.
That's okay. Now, as you go to chapter 1262, conditional use requirements, all of that that's underlined, this is all additional information. Location, RA, RB, RC,
density, and then in lot areas, basically 6, 8, and 14.
Which are the same, right? Just haven't changed.
Yep. The minimum lot area is equal to the minimum lot requirements for the corresponding residential district. On a lot to be used for a PND, a minimum of 4 detached single-family dwelling units around a common green space area are required. The reason that I put that on there is I want to avoid people, I've had people that have wanted to build a second house on their lot. And they, you know, want to then create another driveway, which, you know, and it's not enough lot frontage to be able to split it, so you can have 2 lots. And this is not an accessory dwelling, you know, they want an entire house. So
that wouldn't be allowed in pocket neighborhood development?
What you say is make it 4 as the minimum, that would discourage that. So having 2 big houses on the same lot.
But if we're requiring that it doesn't cover 40% of the property, right, then why not limit it to 2? Or why not limit it?
Because otherwise you can have people that can put a second house on their property.
But it wouldn't necessarily be.
And it's not really going to be a pocket neighborhood development. It's not going to be something that's going to be managed by
a homeowner's
association. And you essentially could potentially have 2 property owners, but the lot, we can't make a non-conforming lot. We can't divide it.
Mm-hmm. But you got 2 driveways, you have 2 utility feeds, you've got 2 water. So you got all this stuff that we're trying to avoid. With the subdivision by.
We're not requiring pocket neighborhoods to only have 1 driveway?
Well, it's the way the parking is, it's different, right? The parking is kind of at the edge of the neighborhood, and then you walk into your.
So, should I go on? On a lot to be used for PND, an existing detached single family residential or duplex structure, which may be non-conforming with respect to the standards of this section, shall be permitted to remain. But the extent of the nonconformity may not be increased, and the existing structure will factor into the maximum lot coverage permitted. And the reason I put that in there was thinking of, you know, someone might find an acre lot that has an existing house on it, and they want to do a pocket neighborhood development, but without making them having to demolish that, and they might even want to turn it into something that's of use for the whole common everyone, or, you know.
Well, that's something that Ted and I talked about, was even though it's not required in here, a lot of these little neighborhoods have a common kitchen or a common or shared guest rooms or things like that, so that maybe that's what you use that
into, like a little clubhouse.
That's almost like clubhouse.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or you're talking about like a community space that has
a community space.
Yes.
Yeah. Rather than knocking down that structure, telling them that they have to knock the structure down. Or they could, you know, they get one of the houses, but they've got to have at least
3 more.
Yeah. This one, I don't know how you feel about that one. The height limit and roof pitch. That's what's allowed in the ARC code currently, but that's for a 2-story. And you know, Ted was saying that he felt, oh, well, like, why not? If they want to have a 2-story.
Yeah.
Sure.
So the maximum, the lot coverage and floor area, I think that we should continue with just the same lot coverage that, let's see, what was that? The maximum lot coverage permitted for principal and accessory structures. Structures in PND shall not exceed 40%.
Does that work as no?
I mean 40% is the, I wonder if we should go back and look at what I think
it's 40% for RA and RB is...
Why don't we make it for the, equal to the corresponding residential district?
Okay.
That way...
Yeah.
We can have density rather than dense areas.
Yeah, 60 for RA, 50 for, right, that's what I'm wrong with, sorry. It's 35 for RA, it's 40 for RB, and it's 50 for RC.
So wouldn't that mean that you would have smaller units in a PND in the RA where there's larger houses? So wouldn't that be kind of like off?
Well, not necessarily.
Town zoning?
Like, you have more room, so you make larger.
You have more room, the lots are larger.
Right, so that you can...
Are the lots larger usually?
Yeah. And the minimum lot requirements are larger.
Okay.
This is one of those things, until you test it, you don't really know if we're gonna run into a problem with it.
That's what I'm thinking.
Yeah.
Are you still gonna have like the 5 feet minimum at the side of the house? So those still, so whatever's in that?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, and I don't know, did I have that in there for setbacks? I should add that, setbacks.
Yeah, I would think that would be helpful to whatever setbacks for the residential area applies.
Well, you have to think about the, let's see.
And then I put no accessory dwelling units are permitted. You can have accessory structures, but no dwelling units. Required open space, a minimum of 400 square feet of open space is required per unit.
Is that common open space?
That's, that was, no, I think that's like around the property that we're, around the area where the house is.
So how much open, common open space is mandatory?
It may be that the 400 is meant to be common.
Common open space.
Well,
if you add the
but it's per unit, so if you have 10 units and it's 4,000 square feet, it's
of common
open space.
Yeah.
Okay, so can we add the word common in number one on E? Does that make sense?
Common.
That makes sense. We'll probably do the math and see
how it... It seems like, you know, but I mean, it could be around the house. It doesn't necessarily, it's just that 50% of the unit shall abut the common open space.
So that would...
All the units shall be within 60 feet walking distance. So I don't understand how you could be 50% of the unit shall abut it and not be within 50 feet of the common open space.
That's probably meant to be
it meant
50%
of the units. Of the unit itself, so...
No, I think you mean units, as in half of the houses need to be on the common space.
No, 50 feet.
And then,
it says,
but all of them should be within 60 feet.
I think it's supposed to be kind of a circle. I think that's how they do it at least. So only 50% of the house would be.
I think that minimum of 400 square feet should stay open space, because I don't think you're necessarily going to have it all as common. Some of it will be the space between your unit and the next one. And I think you think of a common space as that what's going to be like in the center.
Well, then you need to identify a minimal amount of common space.
Yeah.
Why? Because you're already saying, you know, that 400 is required.
That's just open space. It's not common.
Yeah, but I think that in the placement of the house, it's going to, it may be different for, depending on how many units there are.
It just seems like in the way it's written right now, right, you could have open space around each unit and like 5 feet common open space, you know, like 5 foot square, like.
Right.
Well, the one above though does have.
At least 50, except.
Coverage.
It just says abut and within 60 feet. I just don't understand what.
Let's say at least 50% of the units.
Actually, I think there should be an S on that.
Yes. Shall abut the common open.
So half of the houses need to be on the common space.
And all of the units have to be within 60 feet walking distance to the space, and the common open space has to have units abutting at least two sides of it.
Right.
Okay.
So it's forcing them to keep it as close to the common space as possible, yeah.
Okay.
However they design that, I guess would be up to them.
But we still specify, we're not talking about a requirement for common space.
Yeah.
Do we need to do that?
I've got another question. I don't know if you do it here or you do it elsewhere, but do you have setback requirements per dwelling unit given your fire access, et cetera? Because I don't know if this is where you do this or you do that elsewhere, but if this is where you do it, it would seem you need to do it here.
No, I agree. I think you're
yeah.
right.
We're going to have the setback requirements that for regular setback requirements to add. But you're right, then fire access to the dwelling units.
I still think number 1E should be common open space.
400
square feet isn't
per unit.
That.
That's 10 by 40. It's not a huge,
yeah.
huge area.
It's not. Yeah. It's a backyard. You know, it's
right.
a small backyard, so it's saying,
you're saying
there
per
must
unit.
Be a small backyard
right.
amount of area
per unit
somewhere.
That's shared.
Yeah, so you don't have to have a backyard, you have to have setbacks, but you can have your backyard area is part of this common area.
Yeah.
But just saying open space without defining what open space means that it could be taking in all that setback area and then there would be no common.
But in B,
open space.
On, what is it, B5, talks about around a common green space area on a lot to be used for PND, a minimum of 4 detached single family dwelling units around a common green space area.
Mm-hmm.
So right there we're saying.
But that could be, it doesn't, there's no requirement on that.
As
that
to the
common,
size.
Maybe the size of this room.
It could be a tree.
Let's take that to this. Right. I agree with you, Rose. I think
yeah.
we need to say. Whether it's 400 feet or some other number, but I think we need to say that there needs to be some amount of common space.
Well, and you could,
if
maybe
you
do,
yeah. Go ahead.
Also, I don't like it saying green space up there and open space down there.
I was going to say, you might be able to get around that if, and I don't know if this is what you want, but if you set a minimum of 400 square feet, not inclusive of setbacks, or whatever number, not inclusive of setbacks, of common space is required. Or open space, however you're phrasing it.
Mm-hmm.
Should be consistent.
Yeah. I like that they're exclusive of setbacks.
And let me skip forward just a little bit to the definitions. A dwelling, pocket neighborhood development, a detached building designed as part of a group of dwelling units trading individual open space for common open space, and for which each unit is occupied exclusively by one family. And then pocket neighborhood development, a type of planned community which consists of a clustering of smaller residents around a courtyard or common, I'll make it open space area, and designed to promote a sense of community and neighborliness through an increased level of contact.
Okay.
So.
Does that say then fences would not be allowed?
Not necessarily.
I don't know if it's going to address it.
Although the property is owned by the home.
Yeah.
Association.
I guess the HOA has to make those rules, right?
Yeah.
Because I could see a little cottage, a good fence.
Because we'll say, so to me, open space means that you can freely move around.
So now, by saying this, okay, so you're saying 400 feet of open space per unit. So what if in that open space, they want to have a structure that has like a meeting space or a common kitchen?
But it wouldn't be.
But they.
Wouldn't be part of the open space.
Yeah.
It'd be a structure.
It would negate from the amount of open space. Square footage. It would just minus. You could have open space around that structure.
Right.
But it wouldn't reduce the amount that was required. So it would be less likely, probably, that somebody would want to do that additional structure.
Depending, I mean, not necessarily, but.
And like the veil, right, could be kind of talked about like a you know, pocket neighborhood, and they have that open space. And they, you know, they have little, I think there's a little shed in their common area.
But they probably have, in general, more area than what we're talking about here. You know?
I don't know, like that little, where they have the garden and the, you know, how many buildings are in the Vale? Like eight. I think that it's probably less than 400. Square feet of that common, you know what I'm talking about, inside the driveway?
Yeah, probably is less. But what do we want in the village?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing, I guess. Do we want it? I mean, it's 400 per unit. I think maybe what we need to do is maybe do some math and see.
Yeah, I was just trying to see if it's reasonable. That's a concern that I have. Is it reasonable, or are we making it too large?
Maybe it's so big that you can't do anything.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that there would be tiny little houses around a giant.
Yeah. Open space.
Yeah, and that's one of the models too. Is where everyone has a very small house, but then they have a common.
Well, they don't even have to have that small.
But that's one of the reasons we're talking about building this shared structure. This. Shared kitchen and guest room and everything. So it's just a different model. Otherwise, it has a standalone, you know, two bedrooms and full kitchen.
Well, I think the shared space is usually more of a community space.
Yeah.
It's not a matter of that you don't have a kitchen in your own place. It's more of a meeting place that you're trying to create this sense of neighborhood. And so, like, maybe they, because they have a home kitchen association, maybe they want to get together, have their meetings there.
Yep.
Potlucks, whatever.
Well, I can play around with that. I mean, you know, I don't know what the scenarios are going to be, because
it's in there.
We're talking.
You're saying you can't subdivide the property.
Yeah.
And so how are you going to manage that if you were individually selling structures? There needs to be some kind of association.
Okay.
So if you have, you know, if it was one true acre and there's 43,560 square feet in an acre, and you have 14 units, let's say it's RC, which is probably not defined in RC. Or maybe a couple, yeah. And then you've got 1,200 square feet. You're only using 16,800. You do the 400 per unit. That's another 1,400. 400 times those 14 units. I just play it like that. But sometimes it's going to be smaller than an acre. That's the thing. It's going to be.
Yeah.
They're going to try to put 14 units on half an acre, you know?
And that's fine.
Yeah.
As long as they make the requirements.
Yeah.
As long as we don't make the common. I mean, they can have as much. I think what we have to have is minimums, not, you know, minimum requirements.
Yeah.
So that they can have more of common space, but.
Yeah. Did Ted look at this, and did he think the 400 open space per unit was okay?
Yeah.
Okay, well, we're not ready to have a hearing on it anyway.
No, so. No, this is like completely.
We've only been talking about it for 5 months.
Yeah. I mean, to get to this point was pretty exciting, I think.
Thank you so much.
Really good job.
But just to have something that.
Thank you.
Jessica helped me on this a lot, so kudos to her as well. Because just to have something that, I was just trying to wrap my head around this, avoiding the PUD, but yet, how can we do this? How you do that? Then if you have to subdivide all these lots, and you're talking a major subdivision, and there's all of these steps for that, and this is just so much simpler.
Well, you did a really nice job, because you sort of took what we considered the important points, and there's not too much here. Because some of them are so prescriptive of what you really wanted.
Yeah. I think there's an edit here you probably need to make.
Okay.
On G, number 2, the last sentence stated, the dwelling units may be individually owned or rented by the homeowners association. I don't think we're anticipating homeowners association owning these buildings and renting them out.
So
right?
We're just going to say, just don't even say that.
Or I said, or by members of.
Shall be one lot with all open space under control of a homeowners association.
Yeah, that's fine.
Shall be. Located on one lot. And then, so parking, let's see, 1 1/4 spaces per dwelling unit. I don't know if you want to make it 2.
I think we need more.
Per dwelling unit.
Well, I want to be careful about that so that we're not requiring too much and again, making it difficult to.
Yeah. What is it for? 2 per resident, right?
For a detached single family dwelling. But I didn't know if these would tend to be people that, you know,
have only one car per resident.
Yeah. And maybe only one person lives there because they're smaller homes and or maybe they're bicycling to
I don't think we should.
One in the 1.25 spaces.
And since they're not at each, this is like, basically they're going to be parking lots. So if there's 12 units and 1.25 is what we have in the code for senior, so you would say then you have to have 12, 13, 14, 15 lots for those. Those 12, you know, I guess with the idea, you know, too, that people are not always going to be there all the time. And
people will come to visit, but I think it might be a little you want to have.
Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out what is only 2.5 with us.
3. It gives us 3 parking lots.
3 per 12.
Yeah, 3 per 12.
So you build 4, though, that gives you gives you 5 spaces.
No, 4 spaces. Well, you guys, this is not set in stone.
I
literally just took this from.
Yeah,
I've got
to think. You know,
you can stick with the 2, but know that if you're doing 14 houses and you're going to have 28 spaces.
Yeah.
That's not seems like overkill.
Yes. But
one and a half. And I mean, they can also, that's the minimum. Again, we're talking, these are the minimums. You can do more, but that's the minimums. When we were talking about landscaping, and Ted was saying, well, you know, just what the landscape requirements that are currently in our code, we can fall back on that for parking lots.
Oh.
You know, parking lots, you have to have like a buffer of trees or shrubs and that kind of thing. He said, you know, that would apply because you're basically going to make these little parking lots, little parking areas, rather than not all these houses are going to have a space right in front of them.
Some might. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it just depends on how they, what they bring forward.
Would we consider garages after parking spaces?
Yes.
And garages would be allowed?
Be allowed. They have except, we're allowing accessory structures,
okay.
So.
Yeah, and that would count as a space.
Okay.
Whether it's attached or detached.
Parking is parking.
You know, mentioned about the fire access, that's really, or you didn't mention that, Gigi. That's really important because I know I've seen that elsewhere that is kind of a concern. Making sure that.
Yeah.
That whatever they do, you can have access to the
houses. Have a truck be within, yeah.
Yeah. But hopefully with everything being, having to be within 60 feet of a parking space, that will help a little bit. But I'll definitely see what I can find on language on that.
Can I throw something out here, which I hope isn't a monkey wrench, and it's really just a question? Are you permitted to say something like, for pocket neighborhoods consisting of greater than this number of units, at least one must be fully handicap accessible? Can you assign that condition? And because if so, I just think it might be a nice thing to consider, because if you look at who is looking at living in a pocket neighborhood, they're often in veterans communities and that sort of thing. I don't know if you can, I'm throwing that out there.
Right. It's not.
Right.
But I mean, the government regulates that there should be handicapped parking spaces at private buildings. So why wouldn't you be allowed to do that? I guess that's a lawyer question.
Yeah, that's a lawyer question. Then the other is the use.
No, no. But you were talking about handicap
accessible
structure.
The structure itself.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the ADA falls federal money, but
yeah,
I don't know if you can say that.
It's a problem for.
Although, if they. Whoever.
It's conditional. You know, we don't have to approve them.
Even though it's private.
If somebody's building housing for seniors, probably it will be ADA, because you would probably have your wider doorways, your
so.
Space.
Yeah.
That's a good question, Judy.
But if we're allowing this special thing to happen in our village, right, I don't think it, I want a lawyer answer, but I'm guessing that would be something that, you know, we would be able to add as a condition, that one unit be accessible.
Along that, you probably could mandate something about green material building. I mean, there are other things you can probably do.
Yeah. I mean, if they don't want to fill the conditions, then they don't get, you know, they don't get to do this special thing.
This is your crack.
Jessica, can you answer that for us? Can we put that condition on?
I'm going to look into it.
Okay.
Yeah. We we may be, by doing that, limiting growth. Because now,
I think by not doing that, we're limiting growth.
Well, no. Okay, you got a handicap. You build a handicap unit. What if no one wants to move in?
Oh, somebody will.
No. You're assuming someone will, but maybe now you got
handicap units don't limit people to
move in. But there might. She's still looking at it, because once you do parking lots, there's going to probably, whether it's private or not. I mean, you might have to have some.
Yeah.
I mean, it's publicly being accessed. It's just like, you might have to have some requirements as far as the parking lots and the sidewalk sizes and ramps leading up to. Now, as far as the unit itself, and I know we have in the code, haven't looked at it a whole lot, but I know we have in the code a thing on there about affordability, affordable home thing, a language, and I think that was more as a suggestion that if you do that, then you might get some sort of of a break on something else or a requirement of
reasons. Yeah, we're going to give it some type of incentive.
There's a, yeah, some sort of incentive.
And so maybe you write it that way, so.
Yeah, maybe writing.
If you would build X percent of them as handicap accessible, you would get.
Then you get something.
Jessica's gonna check.
Right.
Yeah, just something like that.
We're all probably gonna need that unit sometime.
I know. We can only hope.
And then the next one, okay, so I changed the parking to 1.5 space. The location, just kind of standard language there. For now, the PMD is limited to detached single-family dwelling units. May only, other types of dwellings may only be developed under limits allowed in the zoning code, which might very well still be this. I mean, you know, a PMD shall be located on one lot with all open space under the control of the homeowner association. Okay. And then under parking requirements, I went ahead and made that 1.5 spaces per dwelling. That's table 126402. Under definitions, I took out cluster housing because cluster housing was the term that was being used prior to us going with pocket neighborhood development. So rather than having that in there and getting confusion, maybe striking that out and just putting in the pocket neighborhood development.
Would you add in parentheses after the pocket neighborhood development, parentheses cluster housing?
I mean, we don't have cluster housing that I could find anywhere else in the code, so that's why I was confused why it was in there to begin with.
Yeah.
We have co-housing, I mean, in there, I mean, as ideas for stuff. But I'll look again, but thought it would just be easier just not having it at all. Because the pocket neighborhood development is the same thing. It's a clustering of smaller residents around a courtyard or common open space area. And then lastly, so I put it in there under P, definitions OPQ, P, pocket neighborhood development, and then I also added it as number 6 under dwellings, dwelling pocket neighborhood development.
We need to add in the definition something about individual ownership with a homeowners association, or not?
As the definition of a homeowners association?
No, as the definition of a pocket neighborhood. Consisting of individually owned dwellings.
Oh, in the pocket neighborhood, let's see, and...
It says something like individually owned dwelling units on commonly owned or on commonly owned land or
Something like that, maybe.
Yeah. Let's see. Yeah, I'll play around with that a lot.
So more than one lot takes it out of the pocket neighborhood development.
Not necessarily. If you had adjoining lots that you wanted to combine,
well,
you wouldn't have to combine.
But it says there shall be one lot on the other, the G.
Is our intent in the instance to make it one lot, or can they?
Yeah, that was my intent. It was one lot, one big lot owned by the HOA.
What if you have six, like the college, for instance, RC lots?
Can you combine?
Can you combine them into one pocket neighborhood with a common homeowner association?
No, you just combine them.
Mm-hmm. You just do a replat.
Yeah, a replat.
I mean,
it only goes through to me.
Yeah, I mean, it's you're not
adding numbers of lots.
We're not making a non-conformity. We're mm-hmm. making it larger, and
okay.
we're actually reducing the number of lots rather than
adding.
We're not adding.
Okay, so you still want them to combine them?
I
think so, yes. I think it'd just be cleaner.
Oh, yeah, because if there's lot lines in there, you have to talk about lot setbacks and stuff like that.
Yeah,
I
just think it would be much cleaner.
Okay.
Not to, it's something to think about. My problem is when we talk about homeowners association,
it could just be one person, right? And renting out these units? No.
Well, the homeowners association are all the people that own the units. They become a collective body.
Could they be rental units?
This says that they
own or rented.
Or does they only?
A developer couldn't
take that out.
So a developer couldn't build a pocket neighborhood, rent out the houses. That's not possible. They would have to buy the houses. They're legally obligated to sell the houses to people.
To me, I feel the idea of a pocket neighborhood is that each of these houses are individually owned. With each of them have a family in them. Otherwise, then you're getting into people are going to skirt around this thing of sort of having some like condo thing. And to me, it's like or a house or a.
I thought we were trying to increase rental units and.
They can do that. There's a thing in there for attached. There's we have multifamily. I mean, people can do other types of things,
but not with this.
But not as a pocket
as a pocket neighborhood, which is for other reasons. It's about a shared space.
Right. It's about taking a space and maximizing the density on it.
But only for people who own the property, the buildings, not for people who rent them.
Well, you guys are the ones that just have me hide that out. So I
think it should leave in rental.
I don't think, actually, I just said we didn't want to say buy the homeowners association.
So the dwelling units may be individually owned or rented?
Yeah.
Period.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
Yeah.
Well, then again, just to say, what is to prevent me from purchasing one of those and renting all the rest of it?
Nothing.
Why is that a bad thing?
It just seems to stray from the purpose of the pocket neighborhood.
Does
very
it?
Far. Mm-hmm. It says, I now have an income source instead of I have a community. It just seems
understand why rental communities are not communities. Like a rental apartment building, an apartment building
because
is a
community. Because I have complete control over you. I own all of the properties.
Right, you're the ground.
You're the land, so a landlord isn't allowed to live on the property that they're renting?
I just think it's a different reality than a communal living situation.
But it is a communal living situation.
Where I have control over you.
It's just that some people are more equal than others.
Yeah.
That happens. Yeah. But we're talking about resource distribution, not like interpersonal environment.
Well, it depends on which problem you want to fix. If the problem that you want to address is the inavailability of affordable housing for people who are interested in being able to move to, invest in, locate.
I mean, some people don't want to buy houses.
Sure. I just think it's different housing stock, and you are in the position of saying it can go either way, or we want to address the issue of the lack of affordable housing for purchase.
I just don't
understand why we better
limit it.
I don't know why someone who would have that acre land and that was their purpose wouldn't build multifamily or two family or
may not be allowed. Mm-hmm. It may not be allowed.
Yeah, because they could get more units.
Could be residential.
It's talking about more units per acre, and
Well, that's an interesting point. So let's not try to figure this out right now.
Yeah.
But that's a good question. I mean, that the way it is written, one person could buy, develop the property with multiple rentals, they would essentially be a homeowners association.
Or they would sell the properties and be part of the homeowners
association. Well, I'm just thinking about the East Green, though.
Right? Yeah.
The East Green would be one person essentially is the landlord for everyone. And instead of having a home or apartment, everyone has their own little structure that they're...
It would be an apartment, yeah.
Yeah, standalone.
Yeah, it was attached to a home.
Yeah. So is that what... And so then there's a question of is maybe more transient, not always, people? But then does that defeat the purpose of the communal space or not? So those are all good questions I think we should probably
I agree with what Rose said. Just because people are renting doesn't mean that they're transient or anything like that.
It doesn't mean they're not part of the community.
In Yellow Springs that have rented all their lives.
Exactly.
And there are more people right now that are wanting to rent than actually purchase homes because of what happened in our economy.
Right. And they can't find a place.
Yeah, or there are older people who don't want to own a home. You know, there's a lot of responsibility that goes along with that.
Right.
My only question is, and maybe it's a big, do we have to define what a homeowners association is?
Where are we mentioning? I mean, that's their job.
The developer would do that.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, can we maybe just change that to open space under common control of the individual homeowners?
Yeah, you don't have to put HOA.
Yeah.
Under the control of what?
Under the common control of the individual homeowners.
Under the common.
I think if you have common space, legally, I think you may have to have a homeowner association. Do you know, Jessica, is that true?
No, I don't know that.
Yeah, that's what I was just
saying. Yeah. I mean, we may want to check that. But
I mean, normally, I know that's what the developer does.
Yes.
I mean, an apartment building has common space.
That's not controlled by the individual renters.
Yeah, but it's not required that...
I'll tell you, we're missing something here totally.
Yes.
Okay.
The reason there's an HOA is because it's one lot.
Yeah.
That you have to have property tax. So each member then has to pay a portion of the overall value of that property.
Yes. And they probably each may have to
that's why
contribute or be a part of maintaining that common space.
And if there was one owner, they would pay all the property taxes and the renters would pay them rent.
Right.
But I mean, that's why they have that. I mean, not dividing these up. We're not going to make a bunch of non-conforming lots because
I'm not arguing for that at all.
Okay, so the tax is based on the lot, on the neighborhood.
On the neighborhood, yeah. There's like the entity gets the property tax bill, but your homeowners association fees pay that portion of it.
Yeah. Okay. I think we've.
Yeah.
And it's 9 o'clock. I mean, Jerry and I were talking about the comprehensive plan. I don't know if we want to do this or not, but
let me just say that
Jerry and Denise and I sat down and kind of talked about how we were going to tackle this, and we all just kind of had a starting point.
Are we redoing it?
No. Well, that's our hope, is that we're not redoing it. But the first thing we thought we should do was kind of get the documents to you guys, explain our recollection of the process and some of the things that went into creating the visioning. Because we started with the visioning and then we went to the comprehensive plan. and just kind of explain to you some of the thinking that went into that and some of the process. And then we talked to Denise about maybe trying to update some of the demographics. And so she's included that. And then really what we want to do was have everybody go through this and say, is this still valid? Yeah. We think this is appropriate still. Yeah. Are there parts of it that we need to look at? Is there stuff missing that's come up in the last 6 years that needs to be added? And not redo the whole thing.
Sure. I agree. Because, reading probably this and the vision, that the village has not done one every 10 years. It's more like maybe every 40 years or something that they've done one. So that's why when I was looking at this,
it's supposed to be every 5 years, right?
2010, I thought, you know, because when I was looking at it, I thought it was very good. And
Well, I think a lot of the big goals, I don't think they've changed, but maybe they have in some people's minds. I mean, I think really we were talking, everyone was into talking about sustainability as a village, whether that comes to economic growth, the more people can actually work in the village at a decent paying job so they afford to live here, and then also to come up with affordability questions so that people can afford to live here. And those, I think, were the two main threads that really went through the whole thing.
I agree.
And I don't think that's changed a whole lot.
But I think it's been impacted because the village has not kept up with their infrastructure and so forth. And consequently, when we talk about affordability, then we're saying, well, housing,
Utilities,
jobs, or no jobs, and then also, I keep looking at the statistics, is the average age of our residents, plus the age brackets, where is the bulk of the population? Those are things that I've been looking at, as I look at the plan and say, is it still here? Mm-hmm. Because, you know, if, depending on your mindset, you can't afford to live with what live in the community with the first one. Because if your village is moving more toward folks with fixed income, then one group is going to suffer in terms of affordability. And just some of the thoughts I have. I don't want to go on.
I have a concern on the on page 31 of the comprehensive plan. Second paragraph down, last sentence. It deals with the Glass Farm area, the King Street, Fairfield Pike area. Proper stormwater management will be important for this area. Although the entire area drains to the Glass Farm detention pond, this pond was not intended for or designed to accommodate any new development. There is a big problem because the easement is going into place on that area. And I want to make sure that Jerry and Denise inform the manager and the council that we have to make sure that whatever easement and restrictions are going on the Beaver Dam, that there is enough that we anticipate that we may need to dredge it, we may need to expand it, and that needs to be built into whatever language. I'm concerned about that.
Yeah, I read that too, and I'm saying,
Now, on the Beaver Dam side, that's a conservation area, so the only thing that there could ever be would be some parking. I mean, that which.
But the water is going from the second field up where it will be residential, and then the third field up is the solar. Those areas are going to be developed into residences, correct?
Oh, I don't have any idea at this point.
It's a possibility.
I mean, it's a possibility, but I guess what I'm saying is, there wouldn't be no new development without stormwater plans in place. That would be considered a major subdivision.
Exactly, and the water would flow to that pond.
Yeah.
And
not
so,
necessarily, there would be a plan.
But it may be that you need to build another pond.
Yeah.
Well, that's...
Not on that property, but on the other property.
That's uphill. Water goes downhill.
Yeah, so you got to, so you have to plan on the discharge of that into.
So I'm expressing my concern that we don't preclude by putting the easement on this area, planning for stormwater runoff going into that detention basin. It's only logical.
When you say easement, what are you?
The Tecumseh Land Trust.
Conservation easement. The conservation, because that's was already, we had one before, that's always been a conservation area.
But this will be an easement that is more restrictive.
More restrictive, yeah.
And that's, and I want to make sure that the village can still have that area for stormwater runoff of that development. And
mm-hmm.
that concern I'd like to express.
I see what you're saying. Because I was thinking there wouldn't be much development in that area where the conservation
is. No, not
is.
On that first field.
But you're right, in the middle field. And
that's
and
high ground
right,
going
solar,
down.
Right, yeah, okay.
Yeah,
yeah, I
before,
will.
The deeper than we did that, mm-hmm. the
yes.
Right, and it was dug out because the people downstream were getting
it's
flooded
so,
in their backyard. So
is that
like I want to make sure that
no,
we
so
don't.
That's
don't
that's
yeah. Can you also
bring
that?
Yeah. We're responsible for planning, and I don't want something that restricts that. So, thank you.
No, that's very helpful. She's going to check in too, see, because it's coming up, she said, the next meeting.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Okay, so this is on our plate. We can still talk about this next meeting.
Yes.
See, our next meeting, what page is going to be when?
March.
Unless something comes up, or for sure.
We can't have our meeting on the normal week of the council.
There's no meeting here.
Oh, now,
I can't see.
Oh, that's the special. That's
okay,
the special. February
13th.
It's like a set of different dates.
Can I make a motion to adjourn?
Yes, you may. Okay, motion to adjourn, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it.
Okay.
Wow.
Good job, guys.